Welcome to Second Take, the show that takes a look at the issues behind the news. Two major energy-related developments took place this week. Eskom gave its State of the System update, and BP announced major new investments for South Africa and Mozambique. Terence Creamer joins me to discuss both announcements. Hi, Terence. Starting with the Eskom system update, what were some of the highlights?
Well, I think the main highlight was that Eskom wants to continue with maintenance, and this is long-duration maintenance during the winter of 2013. So last year, for the first time, they did some maintenance in the winter of 2012, but these were short turnaround items. So if there was a crisis, they could bring the plant back up quite quickly and they could use those units. This time they're planning to do 2,000 megawatts of planned maintenance during the winter period, long duration maintenance. Those units will be out, and they say that there's no way they can delay the maintenance any longer because the backlog has built up over the years because they've been running the plant at higher levels because of the tight system. So I think that was the big message, that there's going to be planned capacity that's going to not be available during the winter, whereas usually they make sure that all the capacity that is available it can be brought on, and then there'll just be the unplanned outages. And so the other message on the other side of that was that they need to reduce their unplanned losses during the period. And you know, during the summer months, those of us who track twice a week they bring out a system update, and it never really has dipped below the sort of 6,500 megawatts, often over 7,000 megawatts of unplanned events. And that's, you know, it's a highly volatile number, and it's a very big number. And they're needing to bring that down quite considerably. And the plan over the winter period is to have unplanned events of 4,500 megawatts or less. So that's going to require the system to really operate a lot better than it has been during summer. And they say that that is the traditional pattern. Because you do so much maintenance, it has knock-on effects. And I suppose we don't have as much rain, so the coal is drier and it's easier to handle. So therefore, they're saying that the 4,500 target should be met. So that's about 10% of unplanned outages versus the much higher number that we're currently experiencing. And, you know, I think that the other big thing is that they've got unit one of Kuiberg back, which went tripped unexpectedly. And the flows from Cahora Bassa are starting to come back to, above 1,000 megawatt levels, having dropped quite considerably during the summer.
The big question is whether South Africa runs the risk of returning to load shedding. What is the likelihood of that?
Well, I think that's the other highlight of the way they presented the state of the system update. Usually they said, you know, there was a view that load shedding was a dirty word and therefore we'll never return to load shedding, as was the case in 2008. It was very debilitating, came out of the blue. And I think this time around they're saying maintenance is the most important, and that if there's a risk of the system getting into a critical or catastrophic type blackout event, they will resort to some form of load shedding as a last resort. I think it was emphasized as a last resort. So there's a lot of other tools and levers that can be pulled before we get to that point. They're going to buy as much as possible from municipalities and independent power producers. They're going to try and ensure that there's that lower amount of unplanned events. They've got contracts where they can intervene, for instance, in the BHP bulletin smelters. They can take certain capacity away for certain hours during a week. They've also got contracts with large energy intensive users that they can also draw on in cases where the system's getting tight. But they are saying that the system is tight and vulnerable. So now if we have a event like we did with Cahora Bassa and the flooding and the substation going down at Songo, and we have a Kuiberg type trip, or we have a Duva fire type incident, I think that could tilt the balance, and because you've now got a number of units out for maintenance. So they're going to be fewer internal self-generation levers that they can pull, and therefore load shedding will be one of the levers that they will look at. I think that it's not one that I think that they'll go to easily, And I think they're wanting to send out the message that the system's tight, and they're wanting to say that residential users can play quite a big role in avoiding that sort of rotational load shedding, return to that. And, you know, basically it's the hours of 5 in the evening till 9 at night, that if geysers and pool pumps can be switched off during that period, and lighting that isn't really necessary is switched off, and we can arrange our heating, space heating differently, where we rely maybe more on gas and less on these bar heaters, that can make quite a big impact during that time. But because it's during those times when we all come home and all switch on our lights and all start cooking and putting on our TVs, and those are the period, and then our geysers also running and our pool pumps also running over and above, that is the period where they need to run high levels of plant availability just for those 4 hours. So if we can set our geysers and our pool pumps off during that period, they say for instance 4 million geysers switched off can save 2,000 megawatts over that peak, which it seems could be, that's similar to what they're going to have out on planned maintenance. That could be a saving grace, but it's a lever that's quite outside of their control. So the ones that are inside of their control, I think they will pull, but with so many units out on planned maintenance, there are fewer internal supplier side options, and so they're trying to send the message strongly that residents can play a role, and it'll be interesting to see how people respond to that appeal.
BP also made a significant investment announcement this week.
Yes, 5.5 billion rand is quite a big foreign direct investment into South Africa and Mozambique. 4.7 billion of that is going to come into South Africa. A big portion of that really relates to the upgrade of the SAPREF refinery, which is a joint venture between BP and Shell in Durban. And that investment, which will be, I think, about 2.5 billion from BP and a similar amount from Shell, is really about South Africa's cleaner fuels 2 or CF2 migration. So we currently on as cleaner fuels 1, where we've lowered our sulfur particulates by a certain amount, but there's a desire to improve that. So we've taken the lead out, we've taken some sulfur out, but we want to improve it even further, migrating more and more towards the so-called Euro 5 standard of fuel. And that was the announcement basically that's been made, and they're going to be investing in the upgrade of that plant, and that they're going to start producing CF2 quality fuel from 2017, which is by mid-2017, I think it's July 2017, that's when government regulations kick in, and we're going to need to be, all our fuel needs to be of that quality. But there's been a bit of reticence from the existing refineries to invest, because the cost recovery mechanism for the refiners to make these investments, because there's no new volume. In fact, there's going to be, it's lower volume but higher utilization, so it shouldn't have a big volume impact. There's no new volume, so it's not a highly attractive investment for the refiners to make. It's a regulatory induced upgrade, and therefore there's a feeling that they need to recover those costs somehow through the fuel price, I suppose. And that hasn't been announced yet by government, but they've decided to go in some ways on risk and go ahead with the refinery upgrade. And the government indicated put some pressure on government to finalize the cost recovery mechanism. So they're saying by the second half of this year, we should have visibility, and potentially once with SAPREF going, some of the other companies are likely to also be sharpening their pencils and getting ready to move on their cleaner fuels 2 upgrades. And that actually, from a South Africa perspective, I think brings some certainty, because it wasn't clear what we were going to do from 2017, whether we were going to have to rely a lot more on imports, whether we needed to accelerate a Project Matombo, a Project Mafuta, to try and get manufacturing capacity in place at those new standards. But now that we know that at least one of the big refiners is going ahead with a CF2 investment, and I think that will trigger others to follow suit. So you'll probably have the Cape Town refinery, and you'll probably have the Natref, the Sasolburg refinery, also following suit at some point. That gives some certainty, I think, in terms of how much local production and capacity is going to be available to service the market at the right specification. It's not going to be enough. We're already a big fuel importer. We've got rising demand in this country. So part of the BP investment is in terminals, and I suppose to bring sort of imported fuel in, both in Mozambique and into South Africa. And the next big question for government and for South Africa is to what do we do over the long term? Yes, we're going to have these brownfield upgrades, which won't bring us much more volume in terms of fuel, but will give us the right quality fuel. What are we going to do about the future? Are we going to rely on imports more and more? And that is actually what BP is suggesting, that there's going to be that the world is going to be long on Euro 5 type product, and therefore it makes sense to maybe import quite a lot more. But in the end, it's a security of supply discussion that we have to have. Do we move ahead with the Petrosa refinery project, Matombo? Do we look again at Sasol's Mafuta plan? And I think those decisions need to be made quite soon, because these are long lead time projects, much like the power station investments. They take long first to finalize the environmental impact and the investment decision, but then the building takes long as well. So if we make that choice, so we're getting into that sort of crunch period now, where at least we have, I think, some certainty on the brownfield sites, but we need to understand whether we're going to go for greenfield refinery or whether we feel secure enough to just maybe increase our import capacity at the harbours and then the pipeline, use our pipeline network. So it's, I think, not quite crunch time, but it's coming fast, a bit like what happened in the security of supply around electricity. We need to finalise our security of supply model for liquid fuels.
Thank you. That's the Second Take show for this week. Thank you for watching, and join us again next time for more news analysis.